Actually, yesterday it was announced that we started around 7:30. And we didn't know what to do because we made a mistake and we went on making that mistake again on the radio. Today is a very interesting topic before us, is to discuss the Vishuddhi chakra, which is placed here behind the base of the neck, and which has got 16 pegs. It manifests outside the cervical plexus in the throat for physical action. As you know, for the emotional side, we have got ductus gluteus, and thyroid is the gland which is placed here. This center in the evolution is of greatest importance for human beings. Because this center develops maximum growth. When human beings raise their heads from animal stage to become human beings. As animals, the heads were at an angle towards the ground. First it was just touching parallel, then it was raising higher and higher. Till it came to monkey stage where it was raised slightly higher. And at the human stage only they raised their heads in a straight line. Straight line was over it. Till the straight line, it was the balance between the superego and the ego. First there is superego in the animals when they are looked after by human beings. Animals develop certain conditionings from human beings. Like a dog has to be looked after by human beings. Then the dog is told to do this or that and the conditioning starts. And when this conditioning starts in a dog, he starts developing his superego in a human way. But when a chimpanzee raised his head and tried to become a man, first the head of the first original man was bent like this. In the Ramayana, there is a mention of such race, the missing limbs, where human beings were half monkeys and half human beings. That's about 8,000 years back. Now this center was really fully enlightened by Shri Krishna, who came on this earth in the era called as Dwapara. Rama was in Satyuga and he came in Dwapara. That is about 6,000 years back. And Shri Krishna incarnated as one of the incarnations of Shri Vishnu, who is responsible for our evolutionary process. It is only through Shri Vishnu that we evolve. He is the aspect which gives us dharma. Dharma is our sustenance. Through changing our sustenances or our capacities, we have evolved. Like I can say, carbon was at Muladhara Chakra. And this carbon, the cheap matter, got prana into it, by which it started growing as a living thing. This living thing then grew into higher and higher awareness. Till you reach a stage where you are an animal, and then you have to become a human being. The first human beings were shocked people. That incarnation after incarnations of the short people is called as Vamana. Then there were people who became very conscious of the nature around, and they wanted to have the mastery over the nature. They started doing all kinds of yajnas according to the Vedas. Vedas actually worked out right-hand side both of human beings, and they developed people who were good at reciting Veda mantras and all such things that would give us mastery over the five elements. These people, when they master the five elements, they become very ego-oriented. And instead of only keeping the head in the center, we started pulling it backwards. By pulling it backwards, they started developing their pituitary. And this pituitary was activated so much that they increased their hearts. Than normal, became thin people, started thinking about the future, and the idea of the future started coming into the human beings. It went on till today, where the people have tried to master the five elements. They have developed ego to such an extent that they are extremely ego-oriented, and this ego pushes down superego, as you can see here, the ego that is overdeveloped can push the superego down. So that, in addition to that, people like Freud said that why should we allow ourselves to be conditioned to anything? It's only the human beings who can have good conscience and who can have bad conscience. But as the basic wisdom was lacking, gradually we started using the basic wisdom, and we denied all kinds of conditioning within us by saying, what's wrong, and when we went on like this, saying, what's wrong, what happened was that our ego developed so much that it pushed the superego. The superego was pushed to such an extent that it could not bear it. So, in the modern times, say about 15 years back, we can say about 25 years back, a new generation started showing its effects. Young generation came up and they felt that the ego is too much. We are too bound to material things. We are, instead of enslaving the matter and material powers, we are enslaved by them. This realization started coming into that. Actually started, I should say, about 60 years back. But this grew up very well about 20, 25 years back, very much, or little earlier, we can say about 30 years back. When people started seeing that this ego is no good, this matter is dominating us, it is falsehood. But another thing they felt very strongly was that they are now not integrated to their heart. There was no joy in anything. They did things without any emotions. They were emotionless. There were no feelings for anything. It grew quite a lot, this feeling, till the war came in, Hitler tried to destroy. And at that time, with the incoming of Hitler, people could see the ego of Hitler, and they started seeing that reflection within themselves, that how Hitler could destroy this world by pampering the ego of the people by saying that you belong to a higher race and all those things. And this gave them a big shock. And this big shock made the young people of that time feel that this is not the proper way of our progress. And that's why there's a big disparity in the old people, say, who ruled India, and the people who are today English citizens or who are young people there. The whole idea of ego became very subtle. They thought it was a show-off. If it overdid something, it was too formal. They believed in casual life, a if I don't accept anything, that was over-egoed. But once the ego has developed too much, you cannot get out of it. The more you try to fight, the more it will sit on you. It's not possible. And the superego is once suppressed, can be so suppressed, that you just become nothing but superego. Nothing but ego. And the ego then envelops the heart. Because one of the auras around the heart, which I will be discussing later, is also from your Swadhisthana chakra. And the whole Swadhisthana chakra can go around and completely encompass your heart. And there is a dislocation between your heart and your head. There is a dislocation. Sometimes with shocks in life, also, a person's ego is charged. As I was telling you, that we have to be very kind to our wife and to our husband. If their ego is charged, gradually after 3-4 shocks, they get disintegrated. We give them diseases. We give them horrible things. We have no business to do these things. This is sinful. First of all, to marry someone with all the show and with all the things, and then to make somebody unhappy because you have an ego, or hurt somebody's ego by which making that person emotionally dry. Then a society which is extremely dry develops. This dry society cannot even bear the children. Matter becomes the most important thing. Material possessions become more important. Then all human relationships are ended up and sacrificed at the altar of the sea. But this people, after all, are human beings. They have an emotional being within them. It suffers. So to be emotional, people take to drugs and things, as I told you, to alcohols. Alcoholism grows much more with this kind of society. Just to escape the tortures of ego, they become alcoholic. Once they become alcoholic, the superego starts developing. It starts pushing the ego on one side, and the bombing starts, and the confusion starts. This alcohol, which has been denounced by every primordial master because they were supposed to look after your attention, because the attention not only gets spoiled, but your values do. Values about women's chastity, values about your own chastity, values about your own dignity. I mean, you can do anything with drunkenness. I mean, people do such indignified things, that if you take a photograph or even a picture of such people, they would be shocked that they were behaving like this. So first of all, the dignity, human dignity goes down. The sanctity of marriage is lost. And all the values that are built up in your attention as a human being, through all great blessings of these great saints and great prophets, drops. One by one, you start present without any value for anything. You do not value anything but your ego. Even your material possessions are there to suggest your ego. That's how a person becomes a dry personality. In these circumstances, he thinks that he must also overpower God's powers. Sometimes such things came up that people wanted to have powers like God, and they want to challenge God, but they want to say there is no God. How are we to believe there is God? Because the ego is such a blind thing that it doesn't allow you even to think about God and your relation with God. It's such a blinding thing. It makes you sometimes so stupid. As I told you last time in the seminar we had, that it really makes you absolutely stupid. Now the Vishuddhi chakra is the thing which has started the ego, in the sense that the superego, the conditioning that was in a society, was charged by Shri Krishna. Shri Krishna was a man who was a witness of the pain. He is the one who is the primordial being. In the sense, he is the one who rises to lead the whole He's the Virat. And this being, Shri Krishna, is the one who taught us to be perfectious through Gita. Now, in short, I'll explain to you something about Gita. I'm trying to understand, because it's a very simple thing to understand Gita and to read Gita. There are, I don't know how many criticisms of Gita I've known already, but nobody seems to have picked up the real points of Gita. Krishna was the incarnation of divine diplomacy. Divine diplomacy. Divine diplomacy is a thing by which I also play tricks on you. Because if I cannot give you realization, if you are too argumentative, you try to be a mediocre, then I put you into such situations that you start seeing the point that you are missing the real goal. Now, Gita is nothing but is a complete exposition of his talent as a diplomat. For that, one has to understand the tricks of Shri Krishna. First of all, in the very beginning, at the very outset, the second chapter in Gita, he says that you become a sthita, means you become a realized soul. You become a jnani, means a person whose awareness is enlightened. Of course, in India, as everywhere else, people think jnani means a man who's read many books. It means you should have your realization so that your awareness is enlightened. This is the first thing he said. At the very outset, because he's not a businessman, see. So he says the thing that is there. He only tells this to Arjuna, to nobody else, because he's a diplomat and he knows how people are at that time. That he is not going to tell them that is an incarnation and that he is not going to tell them what is the truth. Because if you tell them the truth, they will hit you hard. He knew this very well. So he only tells Arjuna, who is his bhakta, who is his devotee, that you achieve that. But Arjuna at that time is a medium. He couldn't understand because he said that you are saying you become a witness, achieve your self-realization, and then you go for more to kill people. I can't understand, how can that be? I should kill them before, after the witnessing, how can I kill them? Even if they are poor, even if they are wrong, I cannot meet after realization, because after realization, I will have to be compassionate. This is the mediocrity of Arjuna. That's a very subtle point, I think you touched upon. So Krishna says, he understands, he immediately understands, oh, that diplomacy is needed now. It won't work out straightforward much. Like I would say, a son is sitting out of the hut trying to drive a horse cart. Now the father comes out of the hut and the son says his cart is not moving out of it. So he said, and the first and bring the horse in front of the cart, unless and until it is connected to the horse, it won't move. You have to get connected with the horse, that is the Atma, to the spirit. So he says that you are saying that I have to move the cart, and now you are asking me to move the horse. How can that? Then father understands that this one is not going to be happy. So he plays a trick on him. He says, all right, let it be a trial. But you think, you believe that it is the horse which is pulling the cart. You believe it. Now how Krishna has said is even beautifully, more beautifully than this analogy. I gave you this analogy to see the trick of Shri Krishna. And he had to play it because people are so mediocre. Since the 6,000 years, they have been believing into something nonsensical. That you will see now. He said that he said that if I kill people, then I have the karmas with me. then whatever you do is in the name, is really in all, fully in order with God. If you have to kill, you have to kill. You have to kill the devils, you have to kill the rakshasas. The idea that if you kill somebody is something wrong. I mean, suppose today Hitler was to come, you spare him, he's very wrong. Will you spare a thief? You have to kill. And he said, nobody's killed, I think that's a fact. Nobody does. As I told you, that the spirits kill it. So he said, only you put them out of the state just now. So Krishna says that you should first become realized, become a witness, then you are just an instrument in the hands of God. And he uses you what he likes, and you do whatever he says. If he says you have to kill, you have to kill. If he says you don't kill, you don't kill. Because the power starts moving through you. Now, your own concept of compassion is wrong. How can you compassionate to people that one man can destroy the whole world? Are you to be compassionate to that man? For what? The greatest compassion to him is to put him out. Out of all controls of his powers. This is the greatest compassion. That's what Krishna said. But Arjuna didn't answer. He said, still, how can I do these karmas and hear those theories? How to get rid of the karma? So Krishna played a trick again. He said, okay. He put a very absurd condition. This is what is the essence of diplomacy, is to put an absurd condition and befool a person so that when he reaches the stage and understands that it's absurd, then he gives it up. Otherwise, he will not. So he told Arjuna that, very good. You do not want realization, go ahead. You do all your karmas. And you put the fruit of the karmas at the lotus feet of the God. That's all you do, so you won't have any karmas upon yourself. This is an answer. Before realization, it cannot happen. It cannot happen. Before realization, your ego remains as it is, as you see. It's not sati. Circular it will become. You think I'm very humble, I'm very kind, and this, but you see the ego is there. Ego is there, it's the state of your mind, which is governed with ego. It has to be sucked in by some actualization and actual happening. Not necessarily, oh, you are very humble. Some of the egoistical people are extremely humble, because that's yourself. Exterior. But inside is the ego there. Ego is there. Till it is sucked in, you cannot fight it, you cannot drive it up, you cannot get up. It has to be sucked in. To suck that ego, Kundalini has to rise, you have to get into realization. You have to become the self and not the ego. Your identification with ego must stop. That's only possible if you become the spirit. But he says, all right, doesn't matter. What you do is to do your karmas, like one meeting the cart. But put all your attention to the horse and your cart will move. It will never move, is the point. The answer to this. So he gives such a proposition by which the horse does not move. And after some time you find, what is it? The cart is just there. I'm putting everything, I'm supposed to be putting everything on the horse. Nothing doing. It's not connected, it is just there. Once this confusion is reached, then you take your realization and actualization. This is the point. Unless anything is absurdity is dawned upon you, you will never accept. Because you'll ask the question, why should we do it? Why should we do it? Why? So he says, all right, go ahead. So this is the karma theory that starts. Then whatever karmas you do, you put at the lotus feet of God. So it's a make believe. He put you into a mind, into an illusion. That was important. At that stage, it was important to put you into illusion. Because you would not accept human. See, if you have to take out the butter, you cannot do it with a straight finger, you have to make your finger bend a little. It's like that. So, Arjuna said, what about that? What about devotion to God? These are all our organized regions, churches and our temples and all. What about that? Till that also, he was very careful. He said, in Sanskrit, pushpam phalam svayam, whatever is the fruit, whatever is the flower, or whatever is the water, you give me, I take. What if you should give me a flower, I take. But while giving, he's very careful. Which I don't know people have seen the point or not. He says, by giving, he says, and that you do ananya bhakti, devotion, that is ananya. Now the word ananya is the word which is the real Tibetan word, ananya. It means when you are not the other, when you are realized. You can only do bhakti when you are realized, ananya. Person who is ananya means the one who is not the other. You become one with God. Then you do the bhakti. Very clearly say that you do ananya bhakti. Ananya devotion means devotion when you are not the other, when you are realized. Before that, what is the devotion? Many cleverly said, but nobody sees the point. We have seen people, the other day a gentleman came from a cult. What does it mean? Shri Rama, Shri Krishna, Shri Rama, Shri Krishna. This is not Ananya Bhakti. Ananya Bhakti means when there is no other. Means you become realized. This is the essence of his bhakti. Yoga. In bhakti yoga, he has said that you have to become one with your spirit. Also, by saying Ananya. And by karma, karma yoga is also the same, that whatever work you do, you put at the lotus feet of the Lord, you cannot do absolute realization. But after realization, what happens to you? That you do not say, I do it. You say, it's going, it's coming, it's rising, it's happening, it hurts. You just say, I am getting the Buddha, you don't say, never. It is coming because you know you are not, you feel that. Because it's going from you, have become all of us. You say it is going, it is coming, it is not coming. You don't say I have given relaxation to myself, what do I do? Like a lady came with me to America and she told me that Mother must give relaxation to myself. So not from. And he came all the way from Honolulu. And the Kundalini was frozen to you, try. She said, Mother, please give you relaxation. I said, you are a realized one, you try, you treat. Or give me another certificate that is a realization. She said, how can I know it's not? And why not? It would be a good idea. You are teaching my morning to give me, give me realization, give me realization. Why don't you say you are realized? If I were you, I would say, Baba, you are realized, you better come here because you are here. The Kundalini doesn't try. It's a frozen Kundalini. I said, why don't you do it? She said, how can I know she is not realized? Doesn't give vibration. How can I say that? I said, that's what it is. The Kundalini has to rise. That means you know that it is beyond your ego. It is beyond your ego. You cannot reach. You must have that authority to believe, then only you can do it. As long as there is no authority. You are doing it, that's why that is ego means an illusion that you are doing something. Because you don't know anything, what do you do? As I told you, all dead work tend to the dead. You make a chair, a staircase, oh, you are a big man. Stones you bring from the mountains, make another mountain, oh, you are a big man. Okay? All these are dead energies you are managing, electricity, magnetism, are electricities. All these things are not living energies. Living energy is the synthesis energy of all the energies, which is man, the right hand side. The left hand side is the mana, and in the center is the dharma. All these three energies are synthesized, are integrated energies, because the synthesis is not the word, the being dead to the dead. But we get this completely integrated when the light of the spirit comes to you. And this is the Brahma, is the one that is going from your mind. Is the Brahma, is the Brahma. So this was about me. But it is
what did he do? We have to understand. This child, people say he did not cry something. No, it was not. As I knew from my very childhood, he knew it from his very childhood. He played with the gopis when he was about 4 years of age. There's a guru who said this Shri Krishna. That's why he makes children like that. Imagine he was 4 years of age and this guru is, I think, 50 years of age. Is it the same? If at 4 years age, like an innocent child, he just tried to make them naked because he wanted to raise their kundalini as a child. He could climb. Even my son-in-law, my grandson does that. He climbs on the backs of the people and makes them just like make the kundalini run. He does it many a times. He uses them as a child. That's the best thing. And I told him, why don't you do it in your village? He said, but I don't like it. Have your feet there, otherwise what's the use of exciting the car? So, the child of 4 years played with the gopis. When they were carrying the small pots with water on their heads, he would break the pot. Because and the gopi, the lady, used to go and fill their pitchers in that water, which was a vibrating water. And he would just break that pitcher from the back, so the water would fall from the back, giving awakening to the gopi. See the trick of the child. Because in those days there was no matter at all. Not such poor seekers, one could not talk of seeking in a village of Guru. So he tried these tricks of making the pitcher make the water fall on the back so that the human being would be. Then he asked, also, his gopis and goats used to hold their hands. It's called Ram. So Ram is there, so to speak. Ram used to be there. She said that she used to hold their hands. And they used to hold them. Energy used to pass through them, but she was in partition of energy and he was in partition of the primordial being. That's different. Nowadays you find people hold your hands and fall through the spirits. Mm-hmm. It is such a thing should never be done. It causes lots of problems. Especially emotionally, it's not all stuff.
Before getting realization, he went into his subconscious areas and then he finds you blending with Shri. And he describes this to teenage, like a pyramid, all these things and how he falls down. And then he saw other things also there, which you can read the book and see yourself. But Shri Krishna is very fond of God. Why? It is at this point. You need butter for your sheep. If you have got sinus trouble, heat some butter and take a dropper and pour the heated butter to the nose regularly for 3-4 days. Your sinus will cure. It's a very simple medicine. You just try it. Your colds will cure. Why? Because the inner membrane of the nose with our breathing becomes very, very rough, or we can say cracked, as our hands can get cracked. Now, if the butter is put, say, even on the soup spread, used to do before, nowadays people have become so butter conscious that they don't put it. On the soup, you see the butter on the soup just goes and lines up the trachea and spaces and the throat and these glands. Even the eustachian tube is lined up. See, so that the whole thing becomes very much soft. Even if you have any problem, you can rub hot butter in here. Now the butter has double quality. It's a soft milk fat plus salt. Salt is the quality of the gurus. So it's a combination of guru and the butter. As we gargle with the salt, osmosis takes place. It has a very deep significance. Now, this center is manifested outside, as I told you, by 16 subplexuses, which cover our nose, eyes, throat, our neck, ears, and also the outside of our eyes, the eyelids, and also little muscles that control so many things by this one set. 16 are the petals also of this center, Vishuddhi nature. Vishuddhi means without Vishuddhi. Yes. V means absence of. I mean, it is so shuddha, it is so holy that everything is absent. Vishuddha is the meaning of this gender. It means absolutely holy. And that's why he is a sakshi, he is a witness. He tried to break our conditions in a different way from Freud. First conditioning we had in those days, that a wife and a husband relationship was two conditions. And the wife was dominated by husband, by all family people, and they used to torture and everybody. In his time, a woman was treated just like a slave in those days. Somehow it worked out. Because women supposed to be chased, had to be very good. Well, the man was dominating, and it was a big family system that developed. And with this, people started getting strangled in that family system, which had become dead. So he wanted to flout that process. He said that there is no harm in mixing with men as brothers and sisters. We have to be pure in heart, and they are not brothers and sisters. We should mix up. And we should have proper relationship with each other, understanding that this is my wife, this is my husband, and others are my brothers and sisters. Because it was not allowed for any woman even to get out of houses in those days. It was so much transduced because the mother-in-laws were very strong and they would not allow the daughters to go in. The whole episode of Krishna at Gokul is like this. And all the stories and songs are like that wife says to the husband, oh, my sister-in-laws are away, how can we get up at our So all the story of love between husband and wife, is done. Now, he didn't have some yogis as I have today, and disciples around. And he had to permeate his powers, 16,000 powers he had at this chakra. This chakra is represented here to the head, in front. It's called as the Rakshasa chakra, means the one he became, the very becoming primordial. He was a great chemist. He made them take birth as women. And he got them arrested by a king. Now a social problem was created. These women were with that man. So if according to Indian standards, they are all fish. They have no man. They are all born women. Though they were by force taken, not with their nobility, but in India, any woman who is even taken by force at the time of Sita, it has happened. So she should be discarded, as Rama did, as I told you last time. So he attacked his king and brought all the 16,000 with him. So people said, you have got 16,000 women who are not to be accepted in the society. What will you do? Then nobody is going to marry. He said, I'll marry them. But he told them his pre-plan. She actually, they were his part. And he married them. He said, I'll marry 16,000. It's not a play. See, it's the play of the Virat. He married those 16,000. Now, the five elements that he wanted to control, he said, I want to go on there. We have to have them embodied in some. So he created five women. And he married them also. Now, many people say, oh, Krishna would marry 16,000. And he had five queens and this and that. Are we Shri Krishna? Are we not? Have you got even one power to flow through? If you have one, you can flow through yours. He's the one with 16,000 powers. And these powers are created on this earth to give us an awareness by which we felt that there is God beyond. That there is a that we have to achieve that whole service, that we have to become a witness of the play of the whole. He made us conscious of that was at that time. He said in Gita that this spirit that is within you never dies. It again and again comes back to give you realization. And when you die, the spirit is not die. Nainam tiranti shastrani, nainam dhanat pavaka, na chaitam tredayam dhyapu vishosari. You cannot kill it with a weapon. Neither you can burn it with fire. Neither wind you can blow it off. Neither anything can suck. To prove this, Christ came on this earth. To prove what Krishna had said, Christ came on this earth to show that spirit is eternal. They are all one together. We are the people who cannot see them as them. And sometimes it shocks people when I tell them about the relationship of Shri Krishna and Christ is so. Christ, the name Christ came from the word Christ. And Christian word means the form. That means Krishna came on this earth to sow the seed.
Krishna and Christ is extremely close. I don't want to shock you by telling what relationship it has. Because if there are Christians, they'll be shocked. If there are Hindus, they'll be shocked. And if I tell about these two Muslims, they'll be absolutely amazed. When Muhammad Sahib said, Allahu Akbar, Akbar is the Virat, is Shri Krishna. If you don't mind, I would like to tell you, put your hands and see if I'm telling the truth or not. That Christ was the son of Shri Krishna. When he talks of his father with these two hands, these are the fingers of Vishnu and Shri. This is Shri Krishna's hand. And Shri Krishna, who called him Mahavishnu in the heavens and made him more powerful than his hand, was specially created by Radha, who was such an energy, came on this earth as the mother of Christ. Christ's mother was a lady who lived like a potent energy for Christ. Except for him, nobody knew. That's why at the cross he says, "Behold the mother." That's very important. And he was one of the greatest sons you can think of, your mother. Radha incarnated on this earth. And she brought this immaculate conception. The whole story about it is in the Devi Mahatmya, where the goddess created Mahavishnu out of an egg. And that's why on the Easter we celebrate the egg. Egg is the suggestion of you being the egg and the nest. Easter suggests the second birth of human beings. The name Jesus also comes from the word Yashoda. Yashoda was the foster mother of Sri Krishna, and Radha thought that her name must be brought in, but she was also another palm. So Yashoda is called also as Jasoda in the northern gods, where Krishna did. She was called actually like Jasoda. And the small form of Jasoda is Jesu. And that's why he was called as Jesu or Yesu. In Indian languages, he's called as Yesu, never as Jesu. And even in Hebrew, he's called as Yesu, not as Jesu. You see, this Y and J, like Yugoslavians and all these people use, is a confusion between Y, Y, and J. And these two words are confused in the word Yesu or Jesu. He gave him such powers, according to Devi Mahatmya, that he became the supreme support. He's the support at the Mulaharaj. He's the one who is Ganesha and Mulaharaj. He's the support of the whole universe. And Krishna placed him higher than himself because he incarnated higher than him. And Shri Krishna. If I say the truth, you'll get the vibrations. Just see upon the vibration. The crucifixion of Christ, which I'll tell you later on, is another drama. It's another drama to be played. Now see the difference between the 6,000 years and 2,000 years of Christ. So the 4,000 years passed in between. In that 4,000 years, lots of things had to be decided, and it was decided that Christ should be born in Jerusalem, in these places. Bethlehem, we can call it Jerusalem. Because that was the place which was to be attacked again by the divine forces. And always, most of these primordial masters, they are called as gurus, they are born in that area. And so after, you see, most of these three Zoroastras, one after another, three of them gave one personality to class. Then Muhammad Sahib came in there, Moses came in, Abraham came in, all these people were born in that age. And then Christ came to communicate. They thought that would be the best place where these great primordial masters have worked, that they respect Christ, and that they will be able to understand. People as they are, they killed Muhammad Sahib, but they also killed Christ. They never listened to Moses, they never listened to Christ. People are like that. And today I find many people who call themselves Christians are the people who were there to enjoy his crucifixion, who liked it, supported it, and crucified it. Today they are moving with the Bible in their hand, saying that this is this. so unauthorized, so dangerous. Now, it is better sometimes to read what Krishna has to say about Christ. But just now, today, as we are first dealing with the Vishuddhi Chakra, I'll talk about Christ later. Vishuddhi Chakra has two other points which are very important to be known. I'll take this up because you philosopher from left to right. Left Vishuddhi is on the left hand side and right on the right hand. Right hand side Vishuddhi is the Vishuddhi where when he was the king and called as Vithala and his wife Rukmini, they left hand. This is the Raji, or you can say the Rajasa, means the kingliness or the Rajaguna is called as what? Action. Then he went into action as a king, is on the right hand side. The left hand side is the one when he was born and his early life when he had a sister. The sister was actually the daughter of Yashoda, was sacrificed. It was a big story. How Krishna was born in the jail and was taken by his father and put it in a place called Kukul. And the child in that place where the girl was sent, and she is the one who appears as the lightning. And how she became the lightning when she was killed and announced that your killer is still alive. To the horrible Rakshasa, who was actually the brother of Krishna's mother. And it was announced that the eighth child of this Devaki, his sister, his Kamsa's sister, Kamsa is the Rakshasa, is a devil, will kill him. And this frightened him so much that he started killing all the children that were born to this Devaki, his sister, who was put in the jail. The last one was Shri Krishna, and when he was born, everybody stepped out. And the doors opened up, and his father carried him in a basket, just like Moses did it, and crossed the river Jamuna, and when the river touched Shri Krishna's feet, it again went down, crossed over, went to Gokul, put the child there, took the child of Nan Yashoda, and brought the child back and replaced it. When the child was replaced, you see, it was a girl. So Kamsa came and said, he said, okay, she's a girl, how can it be? So then he just heard the girl and she went up and she announced that the killer of you, Kamsa, is born there and is living very much and he is going to kill you. Beware. And then the story is that how he tried to kill him. So that we forget about that. But the main thing I'm telling you was the sister of Shri. Now the definition problem starts when we get confused about sister's relationship. Or the pure relationships, like a mother. This is Mr. Freud's relationship. All kinds of confusions, creating problems about relationships with other men, other women. There's no understanding. Anyone who's married, unmarried, anything, God's eyes towards her. Whoever did those eyes towards her. That's why Krishna Christ at this point had to say. Because he's connected in eyes, that's why he said that thou shalt not have a dreadful eyes. But that's not possible without realization and seeing when we have advanced so much. So all these perverse ideas about men and women's relationship are there, and in the subconscious they create a kind of a guilt. You know it's wrong, you know in the base of your heart you know. But the egoism is gone so much that people say, what's wrong? That's why I say people in the West are kind of innocent. They know it is not wrong. But in the East, in India, when people know it's wrong, still they're in wrong, means they're not innocent, people are wrong. They know this is wrong and still they do, then they are not innocent. So all those Indians who try to do these things knowingly that it is wrong are the wrong type of people because they have lost their innocence.
Now, this is one of the things why we get to meditate, very meditative. But the second one is even another thing, is just to sit down and analyze yourself. This is a basically is some sort of a funny sort of a belief that is built in us. Or sometimes it is a super ego, some sort of position you start analyzing and just murdering yourself mind. I should not have said this. Why did I do it? I should not have gone there. I should not have. Maybe this stuff could be anything you use. Also go and read and they go on repent and things. And when you have repented, finish them. If you have repented, then it is finished. Why do you want to carry on with the guilt within you and this left side? It's too much. So much so that my hand gets really paralyzed with the vibration going all the time. It's left side. That's why I say, the one thing, one mantra, I'm not guilty, I'm not guilty, I'm not guilty. Because you go on sensing to yourself that you are not guilty. All the time sitting down and analyzing yourself. And also, the society is there. From the very beginning, you should not have done this, you should have been there. This you should not have done, this carpet is spoiled, that is spoiled. This. So the whole thing makes life a guilt. For nothing at all, you are guilty of such a big stuff. And believe that, and the gurus play on it. This is your karma, so you are doomed to give. So on the left you should be, you have this gift with us. On the right you should be, you are extremely talkative and you are very arrogant. Such people can be orators. They can shout at the top of their voices. They can control people with their oratory. The right side is they give that kind of an action. There's so many things one has to say about how the sound comes in, how it becomes awake and here and all that, but literally don't complicate. So now, this is how we have the complications of the left and right. When the center is upset, then you take the responsibility of everything around you. You are running like a mad horse. You are like a bull, I should say. And you do all the good job, and you feel, oh, you are such a nice man, in your heart. You feel, oh, I will help that. Oh, I get it. I'll do it. You take the responsibility of the whole world upon your head and start saying, oh, I feel so bad that I could not help in Vietnam. You cannot help. How are you connected? Oh, I'm so bad about Cambodia. I should have done something. You cannot do it. You're just sitting here in Australia to look after Australian problems, Sydney problems, family problems and your own problems. Start from there, charity begins at home. People always try to see the problems of other people. Like if I'm there, they will tell me, why there is poverty in India? Very serious aspect. I said, who is responsible for our poverty, please? Then, why don't you think of your own problems? When I'm here, I'm not saying it often enough. When I'm in India, I'm Indian after. Why are you Indian? I'm Irish. That's how you should be an Australian to face your problems. What are your problems? Or things are your problems. Like if you're guilty for nothing at all. It's the condition is like that. And then if you get out of the gate, you become Jewish. You say, I hate you, and when you follow the law of me, really bark. There's no softness anymore. Such a horrible voice starts coming that I know about Australians fighting. When you take to drink, you go to the other place. I mean, when we were coming to Australia in the plane, they were drinking so much and talking so much after that, nobody could sleep even for a minute. And so loudly they were talking that I was thinking even fish market in Bombay is better than and they have lost all capacity to understand that there are people who want to sleep. And they are talking so loudly that there was a mouthpiece on the near their lips, the way they went on and on and on. All of them talking very loud. You go to any reception. You don't hear anything, you talk, all right. But the other one does doesn't listen to you, you don't listen to him. They all talk. Wait. You just don't know what they are talking, what you are talking. They say, yes, few not is there and few not is there. And you don't know what they are talking, what they are saying. And then you know that into a reception, then you come out again and go another reception, Then you go, you are around such and such, come on, go, shake hands. Such and such percentage, what is the need? With all this no report, this no understanding. And even if it is flirting, that's all. Which is another, as I told you, is nothing but in the play of the spirit. So you are right. That's why Christ had saw him. And he said, you should, thou shalt not have adultery. Thou shalt not have adultery. Any Christian who has adultery should know that the first step to Christianity is not. He said it so clearly. So very clearly and emphatically to you to understand that your eyes are very important and they have to be pure. They have to be honest and pure eyes. I like the way people in Australia like my honest of telling them everything that is honest. It's so sweet of it. Because some things can be quite hard. Believe and taking, though I can speak softly about that, I'm very clever to put it through. But the way you see it, because perhaps you see that honesty in me, I'm not here to please you or to displease you, but to tell you the truth. In such a way that you do not get a shock and you start absorbing it, because that is what you are asking for. So, at this stage, the awareness becomes collectively conscious. Started becoming collectively conscious. This is the beginning of it. But, now, the incoming advent of Christ was especially that. Thousands of years back, it was back then. It was created with the sound that is the complete energy of God. The word. He is that energy embodied. Because he had to do that the spirit is eternal. He is the spirit. And all these centers, these vibrations are okay, but emission or manifestation of his being. So he cannot be killed because he's spirit. He cannot be dead. He cannot be destroyed. Because it's just the energy of spirit. That was the embodiment of Christ. He was brought on this earth. And he was crucified, so he stood all. This gate here, he had to penetrate. This very important gate here, which is the Agnya Chakra, which he had to penetrate. By penetrating this, he created a space in the ego and the superego. This space is the space where they say that Christ is the one who has taken the sins of human beings. He's the lamb that was sacrificed. In the olden Indians, they used to sacrifice lamb. If you have done anything back, you bring a lamb and sacrifice it at the altar of Christ. Those who do not know about Christ are stupid. And those who know about Christ also sacrifice it. So the karma theory finishes off at the point where Christ lived. Because he's the one who is capable of sucking your ego and superego. On one side, he sucks your ego. On the other side, he sucks your superego. He's the one who drove. He drove the spirits into the pigs, and the pigs ran into the sea. But because of these disciples, he's not depicted fruit. But he so clearly showed that there are spirits and that we have nothing to do with the dead. But the Christians, who call themselves Christians, are just anti-Christians. They have all the dead bodies in the church are sitting on the layers of dead bodies. All the spirits hovering around. Your children are attacked and you are not attacked. I'm not against the church. Church, if it is for the realized souls, is an amazing thing. There's no reality in a church where they do not have Christ. Christ is respect. If a church tries hard to be reborn, then it is a church. Otherwise, the rest of the things are just big services. They are big services. Now, another thing, all the Christian nations are very much interested in all kinds of mistakes, clear voices. Oh, I'm told there are some clear voices, they're very, very flourishing people. It's very dangerous to go near them. Cancer, blood cancer, epilepsy, heart attacks, accidents, financial ruin. All those things that have come to you through these mediums. They have no control over them. They say, she's very good lady, he's very good gentleman. He may be good or bad, but what about the ones which are coming in? Can you see them? Do you know who are coming? It's like a bigger patient without any passes, without any visa. Why go to the dead? But the Christian nations are also in England. It is supposed to be the heart of the world. Every 10th house, somebody sitting with a blanket, talking to the great grandfather, to know where is he generating the property or substance of pain. Every 10th house, you see, and so much then the whatever was left there was completed by our gurus from India. Some of them came out of the jail, they had no place to go, they wore those dresses and went down. To make money. State, Chittu. Some of them are stowaways. They are stowaways. And they became gurus. Whatever they taught is horrible Hindi or horrible Marathi or whatever it is. It has got poor English. English aggressors politically, openly, oriented. But these are themselves slightly from super. And these gurus are making him dance. There is one who wants Rolls Royce. Last time he asked for the Rolls Royce. He got 58, he wanted a 59. Actually, he was going to buy 3 ships, but somehow he didn't learn. And that sort of people are there. And these very wise English people who do not eat their food without the tea coats are held by their kings, by these horrible. Without knowing how much they are different, and even grown-ups and old elderly lords are in it. There was one lord who died, no, lord's son who died. He was trying to fly in the air. The father was with his father and mother downstairs. Father about 70 years of age and wife about 65 were trying to fly downstairs, and upstairs was the daughter-in-law and the son. And the son collapsed. He died. So the lady, the wife came and told that he's dead. So they were very happy. He's now gone to heaven. He's achieved his last energy. He's lost. He's scholarly not. And some surgeons went to tell him. He said, don't tell us. Don't come in our happiness and joy. Our son has gone to heaven and we are all going to go there. What has happened to those brains? They are told that you take a ground, stand on Oxford Street, wear that horrible dress worn by laughing when you got saved, and begging when you go to God. So, he is such nonsense. And for 5, I must tell you, I think that all scholars, learning people, scholars from Oxford and from Cambridge, Oxford, you know, both class combined with an Oxford. They really completely exhausted me. 4 years I worked on them. I said, oh God, these stones, what am I going to do with them? They liked the food I cooked, they liked the house I lived, they liked the way I was, everything, but nothing happened to the money. And then it happened. Very difficult nuts to break, but now, all scholars did that. They found out that Sergio, which is pointed to Sergio. Everything points to Sergio. Everything points to Kundalini. Everything is there. The mathematical logical behavior. Absolutely logical. I'm here because of that, I should say. They always pray. They have a gift about history. That they ill-treated people for very little offenses, like even stealing the bread and all that. They sent away these people there. Now I feel thank God. It's a heaven. You got heaven as a punishment compared to that dirty gender now. It's nice to go and see every time you go out to have an umbrella, even people play football with an umbrella at the time. It's a massive, precarious place, I don't know. But it is the, heart of the image. Everything circulates from there. All your laws, all your governing things, everything comes from there. So, I have to work very hard, I know. Now we have really beautiful surroundings, which are tremendous. And thanks to William Blake, he has already prophesied so much about Sahaja, about what will happen, even where I live, where ashram will be, everything so much in detail that now things are getting very much better. So now come back from there to our Agnya center. My class came. There is ego or superego. Came at a point which is in the center of the ego or superego, which is controlled by the pituitary, the ego is controlled, and the pineal body controls the symbol. In between them, and the optic chiasm, by the center of the optic chiasm. That's why eyes are very important for me, because eyes are controlled by the pituitary. There are two pedals to that. Hum, these are the two sounds that come out of those feelings. Hum, chum. On one side, third side. When the person is in super. Masochist, they call them people of masochist. Who like domination, who like beating me up and all. I mean, extreme cases. I mean, in India, we do not have this extreme style. We have people who are submitting, or we have people who are unaware at the most. But this the husband beating the wife, with a hunter or women and some women like me. This kind of nonsense, I'm not sure. But you see, you go to such extremes in everything you want to solve. All right. If we have to be suppressed, all right. Let us get teachers. Let us go on suffering. Why should you suffer? Christ has suffered for you. What is the need for you to suffer? I just don't understand. I make a drama out of it. We are suffering. Ladies, Rahul. Like the French. French are very gravel. Only very difficult people. You can't carry on. They think they are very gravel, making everybody miserable. In the same way, we also take to this kind of an idea. Oh, we are suffering. We are very unhappy people. We start all sorts of nonsensical emotional dramas we play. And why are you laughing? Why are you enjoying yourself? Like I went to France, I told you, they told you, but I don't say that you are an actor. They won't like it, they'll think you are not sensitive. But really? Then I wish you to be far out of the old stuff. But this is what it is. We go to the extreme, we torture ourselves, we go on condemning ourselves. Oh, I'm so bad, I'm good for nothing. We are a gentleman like that. He did only one thing, is to leave Lord Pine. That man should never be touched. What a life he had. He himself was a horrible, licentious man, and he writes about prisoner in Shri. This Lord Byron, he met. Now he became the prisoner, you see. Without any prison, without any. He's the prisoner, system. His name is Ronnie. And Ronnie means the one who cries in Indian language, Ronnie. So this Mr. Ronnie, all the time used to cry, he sleep in his bed, have his food in his bed, I'm very sorry, I am this and that. This is what my mother got fed up with. Wife ran away, also he was crying for that. The son ran away, crying from that. The mother said that you get out of this house. So he's crying for that. She doesn't love me. Then he came to me, said, Mother, I would like to wash your kitchen. And I said, you see, there is no meat. I have got my own people here, staff, you don't have it. Now will you please change your attitude towards life? He said, Mother, I try, this I try, and he realization, try. But he has the habit. I said, all right. We sent him back to his mother. 3 days later, she rang me up that you please take your son away from me. I'm fed up of him. He's come here, he's sleeping in his bed as usual, he's gone back to the same, and he's doing no work, and who for him, otherwise he's starved himself, and he thinks he's the most miserable man you've ever had. You see, this is the substance. It's the super people on one side. The other are the aggressive. Actually, the very aggressive people can become conscious people, because they're afraid of the meat. Like in England, I was surprised, people are very frightened. Very frightened. Extremely frightened people. You know, Indians are not. I mean, if you need anything, you better telephone to them and go to their house. Otherwise, if you go and knock at their door, they might die of heart failure. They are so frightened, most of us. Extremely frightened. You cannot say anything to them, they just get like this. What are they frightened about? I don't understand. Extremely frightened people they are. In India, it is also. In India, supposing somebody knocks you at the night, immediately you came. Oh, maybe your friend has come, he may be in difficulties. Immediately the husband would ask the wife, you have sufficient money in the house, remember? Or have you got some ornaments? He may need some money, otherwise, why has he come? Maybe some problem with it. It's like that. Just open the door immediately without thinking. That's, and the thieves in India don't knock at the door and come in. I mean, there are not expert burglars, see, as we are in. They are naive. So their thinking also is mostly of no value. Actually, in my house, in my father's house, we never knock on the house, never. All our rooms were open morning to evening. My father said, if you lock the house, the people will think there's something in the house, that's why it's locked. Okay, please keep it open. We leave everything open so anybody can walk in, and with a knife, nobody takes it. I mean, we were like that. But now we have learned how to think and how to do things. And that's why the problem is different. Alright, so we have Christ in this place where this red mountain is. Sitting at the crossing. Sitting at the crossing point, and this crossing point he has done for us. He has taken our karma, the sins, upon himself. The Hindus should now realize that they need not go about with their karma theory before even river. They do not want to talk of Christ, because they know their karma theory fails. If he has been sacrificed for our sins, either he was a false guru or they are true gurus, then how can we build up our karma? If we become the spirit, all our karmas will be sacrificed fast, who is awakened in that. So all the karma theories go away. All the sacrifices, spices go away. All these ideas must go away. And when I talk about these things, Hindus blame me that you are a Christian. And when I talk about Krishna, the Christians say that you are a Hindu. Some say I am Muslim, some say I am. What am I? I am everything else. Because I know all of them are one, in one body, in one person. They all exist. In one person, in every human being, and no use disintegrating them and suffering the problems of disintegration. I am a Christian, I am a Muslim, I am a Muslim. You are that because you are born. Do you think about it? You accepted it just because you are born. What happened? What did your forefathers say? All your people have been going to the same thing. You are a Hindu, you are going like a Hindu. If you are a Christian, you are going like a Christian. If you are a Muslim, you are going like a Muslim family. It's all that nonsense you have been doing for ages together until you get your realization in the first part. Even in the Gita, the first thing is that if through Veda, Veda word means to know. Veda means to know. And Veda means by which you know. If these Vedas cannot make you know, then they are useless. The themselves are confessed. So we see here Christ standing at the gate of three centers, three powers. Mahakali, Mahalakshmi powers. He's the one who is controlling all these three powers within us. By one power, he controls all our super egos. He controls all the devils and spirits. If you show the cross, the devils are not. It's gone. He controls our ego on the right hand side. Though the Christians are the most ego-oriented. Whatever they profess, they are just a positive. And then he controls the dharma within us by which he makes us right around towards the center, to be our spirit. He controls that center within us. And this center is the center where your eyes become pure. That your superego at the back is clear. That your ego is subtle. And from your eyes flows nothing. But just compassion. Just compassion. And love of God. And the devotees have adoration. And nothing else. One lecture is not sufficient to describe Christ. Nor it is sufficient to describe Shri Krishna. I've spoken for hours, days together. And this lecture has taken too much time because I've tackled two very important centers together. I hope you will not sit on certain words or certain thoughts and just try to denounce the truth. This is the truth. I have come here to tell you the truth. I am not to please you. Your ego, to please your ego, or to excite your superego, but to comfort you and to make you